this one.
Oh, yeah, what do you have?
I got When I Was on Jimmy Kimmel, Christmas Lights, Vegas for some reason, Jennifer Coolidge, that random TV screen glitch
Ratchet,
thing,
yep.
or Zelda. I
I go to Jimmy Kimmel.
had this one before,
Yeah,
which I can't believe I fucking left on before I had one of the job interviews. Welcome back, ghoulies, to the Complete Guide to Horror podcast. Today, we're talking about The People Under the Stairs, the 1991 film in which a young boy and two adult robbers become trapped in a house belonging to a very strange, very fucked up strange couple after breaking in to steal their collection of rare coins.
In every neighborhood, there is one house that adults whisper about and children cross the street to avoid. Now, Wes Craven, creator of A Nightmare on Elm Street, takes you inside.
Something's in there.
We gotta get out of here, Leroy.
All sorts of rumors about what goes on in that house. The police never took it serious.
She's been feeding that thing between the walls again.
Very, very tense about this.
What goes on in this house is a sin. But what goes on under the stairs is a nightmare. Wes Craven's The People Under the Stairs.
Now, Wes Craven has stated that The People Under the Stairs was partially inspired by a news story from the late 70s in which two burglars broke into a Los Angeles household, inadvertently causing the police to discover two children who had been locked away by their parents. The film was a surprise commercial success and has been analyzed for its satirical depiction of gentrification, class warfare, and capitalism. I'm familiar with three of those words, so yeah. We'll get into it. So I remember I watched this movie for the first time at your house, Coop, way, 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 way back, you know, during the horror movie marathons of the mid-2000s. And again, like, it was my overall introduction to Wes Craven, because I remember we'd watch like Nightmare on Elm Street. You know, my experience with Wes Craven up until that point had been purely Scream as opposed to his other work. So, you know, I think, yet again, this is another underrated horror by Wes Craven that most people, I think, know of, but I don't think they've necessarily watched the full movie. So, you know, the characters are written with some really complex character studies. The parents are insane.
I am crazier.
That's not something to be fucking proud of, Cassie.
No, but it is something you should be scared of.
Initially watched it when I was very young, so I didn't really understand a lot of the themes with like the landlords and capitalism and sort of the divide between the rich and the poor. I didn't really get that. I was just like, what's this crazy movie with these people under these stairs? What's this? But you know, watching it over the years and sort of getting those themes, I've been like, fuck, this movie has a lot of layers to it. And it is, on top of that, a very campy, fun ride. And the characters of Mummy and Daddy are ridiculous. And particularly when Daddy dons the gimp suit, gets out his rifle and starts chasing Roach in the walls, sets the dog on him. And just all the outrageous lines and all his outbursts are just ridiculous. What's the actress name? Wendy Roby does an awesome job as Mummy. She's crazy. Basically, as a kid, I always saw her as like evil Julia Roberts was basically what this character was in my mind. I was like, oh, this is crazy. This is Erin Brockovich gone wild. Just imagine that.
Two wrong feet in fucking ugly shoes.
All the characters in this a lot of fun. I think Fool is a really good sort of main character to follow through on this journey. You always feel really bad for Alice. Who in the end overcomes and kills her mother, or well, not her mother, the woman who stole her and was pretending to be her mother. Again, layers to this movie. But yeah, no, I love it. It was my recommendation because I think it's a fun ride, even if you want it, whether or not you jump on board for the themes, I think it's an enjoyable movie. And it seems to be a lot of movie that a lot of people aren't aware of or haven't heard of. Even people that are quite familiar with Wes Craven might not have heard of or seen this movie. And it has Ving Rhames in it, so obviously, like, it's a good time.
Yeah, it's interesting for me, and a little bit of a sidebar, but with the poster, for some reason, and there's nothing to be confused about, but I always mix up the posters between The People Under the Stairs and Fright Night, because both feature a house.
I can see that.
And yet, for some reason, I always think, oh, People Under the Stairs, it's the one with the ghost face. And I'm like, no, wait, it's a skull in People Under the Stairs. But there's one part of this movie where, I don't know why it stuck with me per se, but it's when the mummy character throws the main character into the bathtub full of hot water, and you can see the steam coming out from the water.
Horrible.
Yeah.
And the way that the actress, you know, screams and everything, it portrayed so well.
Now get in that tub and scrub yourself!
No!
You want to get in, huh? Well, let me help you!
It would have been a very simple effect where obviously it would have been lukewarm water. They're not going to throw an actual actress into boiling water.
No. What?
But I've talked about this a few times now. I love practical effects as opposed to CGI. And even something simple like just having a smoke machine or a steam machine, I don't know what they would have used, maybe like dry ice or something to give the illusion of the bathwater being super hot, just really adds to that scene in terms of horror, but also really showcases the parents as being these fucking psychotic cunts. But BP, do you have any thoughts?
Well, this is the first time I've seen it as well, and I just saw this today. It's funny because I spoke to someone the other day about what we were watching, and I mentioned this. I didn't hear anything, and then as soon as I said, what's that previous movie we just talked about?
Donnie Darko.
They're like, oh yeah, I know that one. But they did say anything about People Under the Stairs. So I don't know. I feel like I may have heard this one somewhere, but never actually invested into it. And I didn't even know Wes Craven was attached to it. I actually quite liked it. As Coop said, I actually enjoyed sort of, I guess, the banter, the acting of Mummy and Daddy. I think that's what really made it. And every time the daddy would act out and kind of go into these tangents, all I kept getting was Jim Carrey could have played this role and he would have just like got even further with it. But it's just literally like this Jim Carrey.
And I go, I must find a way to stop Christmas from coming. You know, and their parents go, oh, I thought it was makeup.
You know? It was surprisingly gory in some areas, just even with some shots of the blood or like even with the tongue. The guy opened his mouth up and showed his tongue cut off. But it's also, I guess, quite sad in terms of, I guess, you know, Alice and, you know, getting lashed. And it was, I actually felt really uncomfortable when she didn't return the fork initially. And then the creature gave her the fork. And then the mum walked out. And then the dad had the belt. And it was just kind of that shot. And then, I just, you know, I'm getting like Law and Order vibes here.
Really dark.
But surprisingly like effective, good pacing. Thoroughly enjoyable, but it raises issues.
If you've got an issue, here's a tissue.
Oh, I was rooting for the parents to die.
Yeah.
That happens. As the first time watcher, I thought it was quite good.
Nice. Yeah. Whenever I think about the camp factor of this movie, so I feel like Wes Craven manages to strike the right balance between it being so over the top, especially when it comes to the mummy and daddy characters, but it's not necessarily so over the top that it ruins the horrific factor of this movie. I can still both laugh at some of the dialogue and some of the character mannerisms and behaviors without it taking me out of the picture entirely. So for me, I really appreciate just how committed the actors are to their performances. Can you imagine telling like a male actor in 1991 that they're gonna have to put on a gimp suit? I think the only other association before that would have been Pulp Fiction, but Pulp Fiction came out in 1994, so this was a predecessor to that. The only real association with like gimp suits and everything would have been like, you know, your leather hardcore gay culture and whatnot.
And then, if anything, now I would just think American Horror Story.
Yeah. Mm. So, I'm actually wondering how did Wes Craven come up with this idea now? But no, it's I really appreciated that factor. So for me, that's my favorite part of the movie. I think establishing atmosphere, establishing strong characters, really helps sell a movie. And also considering this was released 31 years ago, I really enjoyed rewatching it. So, you know, I can't say the same for some other early 90s movies. I think 70s and 80s horror typically still has a lot of rewatch value, but early 90s, maybe late 90s, not so much, unless it's a nostalgic value. Like maybe it's because it was the first horror movie you ever watched, or it was a movie you might have watched with like your older siblings or your parents. That's why you enjoy rewatching it. But this one, I enjoyed it for many, many different reasons. So, yeah. But, Coop, did you have a particular favorite part?
I'm inclined to probably like a lot of this movie. But like I mentioned before, Daddy going crazy, putting on the gimp suit, running around and like chasing Roach, setting the dog on him. And that later scene as well, when Fool and Alice are in the walls, and he sends the dog after them, and he ends up thinking that he's killed Fool, but he's actually killed the dog. And he's coming out and he's dancing and he's being a dickhead. And he's like, I got him. It's just the most ridiculous thing. But this movie as a whole is quite enjoyable. But of course, the characters of Mummy and Daddy just being ridiculous. And then, of course, you've got that revelation later on that they're brother and sister as well. Just whole other levels of fucked up, so.
And this time, I don't want your car. I want you.
Oh, Catherine, that's disgusting. You're my sister.
Only by blood.
Oh, God! What is wrong with this family?
Yeah, I'm with Coop when he does the song and dance about killing the dog, and then she goes, "Well, you better find out if you killed him." And then he goes up and then realizes the dog comes out, I think, and then like dies on the scene. And then they both start crying. But yeah, I think it's just the acting and just it's good chemistry between those two that make it. And as much as like it is a bad scene, the scene with the bathtub is such good acting. Because like you said, I watched it thinking, is it hot? And I'm like, I don't think it is, but they've obviously done some special effect there, but the acting is really good in that, especially for like a child actor, because most of the time they just get annoying really quick. Those are those factors I like.
I'm trying to think of any part of this movie that I disliked, but I'll be honest, I'm struggling. There's no particular flaw in this movie for me. Like, at the very best, maybe I could criticize its color grading, but you know, you'd have to put that in the same context of the fact that this is a 1991 movie, and that, you know, maybe it could have been. No, I'm not actually sure what to say, so I might have to divert this question actually to you two. Coop, did you have any least favorite parts of the movie?
It was sad that Roach died, but I guess it kind of makes sense with the direction of the story. So I guess it's not really a bad point. There is this bit when Alice falls through the ceiling and whacks the mum's head on the ground. It looks really, it looks like fast forward.
Well, that's all from Australia's most pointless TV show. Tune in next week when I laugh so hard my breasts explode.
I used to watch that heaps when I was younger, because we had it on videotape and I'd always put it back. And it looks like yeah, it's like they've sped it up, so she's coming real slowly and then gone like this. But it's just like, whoosh, it just looks really funny and really fake. But other than that, no, don't really have any sort of bad points with this movie.
BP, same question.
There's nothing really. I mean, the only thing that sort of I was just nitpicking was probably the start was maybe just a little slow to get into it. Once it's in the house, it starts. The pacing's pretty good there, but the sort of the intro, probably about 20, 25 minutes, I guess, before it sort of happens. But it's like any movie. I mean, yeah. Sometimes it's a good thing, sometimes it's a bad thing. But for me, if it was a little bit faster and sped up, it'd be probably a bit nicer to get you in there. And, yeah, but once you're in the house and everything's going on, it's pretty good pacing from there.
Yeah. Can you imagine if this movie was released in the early 80s when Friday the 13th had I think I counted it the other day, it was a 12-minute opening sequence just dedicated to the titles, like starring this person, directed by, color grading by, assistant food caterer number 7. That's just like, will you start the movie already?
Like, who's watching the movie like, oh, that's the food caterer. Is that the food from the food caterer 7?
Assistant to the assistant of, yeah.
Yeah, best boy. I was like, who's the best boy?
I tell you what, I still have no fucking idea what a best boy is supposed to be. I've heard so many different weird job titles, and I don't work in the feature film industry, so I'm just like, all right, I think that's like something to do with lighting or rigging or some bullshit, but
all I know is that obviously the worst boy isn't good enough to be ever listed in the credits.
I'm more off-putting.
I'm more unattractive to put in a lead role.
Well, I'm a bigger box office drag.
Kids, you're both just awful.
With the news that there is supposed to be a remake directed by Jordan Peele. So should clarify too that it is due to be produced by Monkey Paw Productions, which is Jordan Peele's film production company. It's not necessarily to say he will direct it, because Candyman, the remake, was also under Monkey Paw Productions, but it was directed by someone else. Do we think People Under the Stairs holds up 31 years later after release? And will you watch the proposed remake by Jordan Peele's company, or do we sense some hesitations? So personally, I do think this movie does hold up today. I think it's the right mixture of like a pure horror, but also it has some exciting content within it. And I think if people take away their perhaps tunnel vision of Wes Craven as just the Scream person, maybe they will enjoy this movie more, but they just have to give it a chance. I know that, you know, most of our listeners are probably, you know, 20 to 30 years of age, probably would never watch a movie released before 1995, but I think it still has its current currency. Get your currency in check. I don't know what the fuck to say, but yeah, in terms of a remake, I'll be honest, I like Jordan Peele. I still haven't seen Nope, so I don't know if that's a good movie. I did like Get Out and Us, but every other movie under Monkey Paw Productions, I didn't like the Candyman remake. I didn't like, there's, oh, fuck, what's that movie? There's another movie they did and I didn't really like it. They also did the recent reboot of The Twilight Zone, and there were some really good episodes in there, and I'm a hardcore Twilight Zone stan. I've got, like, collector's cards, I've got all the DVDs and shit, but I felt that there were some... I actually liked all the episodes that Jordan Peele didn't write, so maybe a little controversial, but I felt that...
Yeah.
It was a lot better without his involvement per se. So I don't know if I'd be excited to watch a remake per se, but definitely be curious. I'd check out the posters and the trailers. But yeah, what are your thoughts, Coop?
I mean, rewatching People Under the Stairs, I think it holds up as like a good concept, good movie. So it would be interesting to see how this remake happens, and sort of what it looks like in a modern context, and particularly with Jordan Peele's approach. I liked Get Out. I thought it was, you know, nice and suspenseful and sort of kept me interested. I wasn't really that into Us. I haven't really seen much else. I've seen a lot of his comedy stuff as well. His comedy's really good. So yeah, I'm quite interested to see it, and yeah, see what he can do with it in a modern context. I'll definitely go and check it out and see what I think, because I mean, I love this movie, so I'm always, even when it goes to shit, I try to stay optimistic about remakes and things coming out, but you know, sometimes we get disappointed, and that's just the way it is, but fingers crossed, hopefully you can pull it off.
Yeah. BP, do you have any thoughts?
Well, I think it's like a bit of a issue to Hollywood that we should probably stop doing this remake. Like, it's just getting ridiculous. I personally don't think this movie needs a remake at the moment. I think it still holds up quite well now. So it's a bit disappointing to see that someone coming in for, you know, 30 years later, they want to do a remake on it. But like everything recently, it's remake everywhere. Jordan Peele being attached to it, I don't have anything against the guy. I'm with Coop. I liked Get Out. Us wasn't too big of a fan, and I did see Nope earlier this week. And Nope was pretty good. It sort of is in line with what I thought it would be. So I think if Jordan Peele's attached to it, it's going to be at least average, if not maybe a little bit better than average. That's how I'm sort of taking it. But I wonder if he's remaking it, if it's going to be something like Cabin Fever, which literally went script for script with both, I think, 2001 and then the 2018 version, whatever it was, or if they're going to just remake it and maybe just change it a little bit in terms of the plot. It'd be interesting to see what way they're going to go with it. But if it does come out, like when it does release, I'll see it. But I don't know. It'd just probably be everyone cashing in Hollywood for remake. So I'm not holding my breath. It's going to be any better than the 1991 version.
Yeah. I think, even though I just talked shit about Jordan Peele before saying, like, I didn't like his Twilight Zone episodes, right? But I think if he's going to do a remake, I don't think it'll be necessarily shot for shot. I could see Jordan Peele putting in some commentary, especially with what this movie had around gentrification, around class warfare. But I think instead of it being like rich versus poor, it might be like a black versus white in the same sense. Like maybe it's like a rich white couple who imprison, you know, like black people under the stairs or something, but it's more of a sinister approach, very similar to Get Out, where they abducted the black people to try and steal their bodies so that they could be younger and fitter and everything. But also, I wouldn't be surprised if there was also some additional commentary on, like with how Get Out, there was the commentary on the the white couple that would constantly say weird shit all the time, like, I would have voted for Obama a third time. And it's like, we all know these people. I know I used to be one of those people back in my early 20s, trying to be like, you know, oh yeah, I want to make sure that I'm not saying the wrong thing, so I'm going to say the most stupid stereotypical bullshit to try and like make black friends and whatnot. And it's like, you don't need to do that. Like, why are you treating someone else differently by trying to, like, you know, what's the word, make it seem like you're in their crowd and whatnot. Like, just treat everyone with the same level of respect, which I think is what Jordan Peele was trying to get at. But yeah, us, on the other hand, I go through stages where I like that movie, then I don't like it, then I do like it, but I hate the plot holes with it. But yeah, I'm still yet to see Nope, so I'm going to check that out pretty soon. I have a feeling the remake might go the way of Candyman, where, like, I will say, I didn't like the horror elements of Candyman, but I appreciated that the whole concept for that movie, spoiler alert, was all about intergenerational trauma and also about, like, continuing the legacy of Candyman from the 90s compared to modern day, and how it was still yet again about gentrification, but it was also about the class divide between white people versus black people, but even again between like rich black people versus poor black people. So yeah, I have no doubt that he'll make it a bit more interesting, and I think that'll help give it its own identity as opposed to Cabin Fever or fucking Child's Play, which well, if you would like to listen to our rants, click episode 35. No, but yeah, I think only time will tell. But BP and Coop, just wanted to say thank you both again very much for joining me.
It was a pleasure.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Listeners, in our next episode, we analyze Rest Stop, the 2006 direct-to-DVD film in which a young woman is threatened by a maniac serial killer after her boyfriend is abducted in a rest stop. Think Wolf Creek meets Dead End meets Wrong Turn, but without arrows. Anyway, like, comment, share, tip, yada, yada, yada. And if you hated this episode...
I'm tired of fucking around. So either put the gun down now or kiss your ass goodbye, boy.